See, at the beginning of the year, I was given the opportunity to step into a shepherding role down at the prison. And just give you my testimony with this a little bit. It all started like about 8 years ago on a Wednesday night when Gene O'Neill got up at fellowship and he just randomly needed some more volunteers to go down there. And he said, I need some young men that would like to go down there. And, you know, once a month, not a big commitment. I remember exactly where I was sitting in the fellowship hall. Because, like, the Lord, you know, when the Lord has his finger on you and he tells you you're supposed to do something, and it's like, it's the stillest, quietest, loudest voice you could ever hear. Yeah. And before I threw up, I jumped up and I ran over to Jonathan, my best friend. I go, Jonathan, I'm supposed to do this. You got to come with me. And of course, good buddy. He just said, okay. So he went and signed up. He went down there one time. And then he go again after that. But I found something that I was passionate about. It was a cool opportunity. And really, to be transparent with you, I was at a phase in my life where I was really good at doing things. But I think I was kind of hiding from what I was supposed to be doing. It's pretty easy to run without going anywhere by letting your works go for you. Carla, I'm going to apologize because she had to listen to me last night and now she has to listen to me again today. Don't tell anybody. No. But the Lord, through those 8 years, I stuck with it. There was times where I wanted to quit. And going down there, he began to teach me a new side of walking with him. It's pretty cool because up to that point, I was a do-it-yourselfer. I don't know. There's a lot of different kinds of Christians, a lot of different ways of approaching it. But me, I kind of disregarded the grace aspect of it. I was more of a get-it-done kind of guy. You could always call me. I'd come help. I was more than willing all the time. I'll help you move. I'll help you move again next week. I'll deliver wood for you. I'll clean the toilets. I'll shampoo the carpets. All these things, none of them being wrong, but they were what equaled my walk with the Lord up to that point. And then God had different plans. And when Papa Gene went to be with the Lord, and the call was there. I was blessed enough to talk with him a few times before he passed, and it was life-changing. So anyway, then God anointed what I'm supposed to do. Holy cow. Like I was just sharing with Dawn and how she got a chance to step into what the Lord has called her. And I'll tell you, there is no greater privilege than what I get to do every Saturday night. I go down there. I get to minister to a bunch of men who love the Lord, who are passionate for him. The difference is they got caught for their sins, right? Let's just be real about it. Those guys down there, yeah, there's some guys that are straight off the streets or right out of the hole who've been doing a lot of time. The inmate pastor down there has been down for 18 years. He doesn't have a release date ahead of him. The Lord burdened me with this: bring hope to the hopeless. You want to talk about hopeless? To know that those fences define your amount of freedom that you'll ever have physically. But now we, as ministers, as brothers, sisters, have to bring them a real reason to live. That'll change your life. You experienced that one time. Holy cow. That changed how I saw destitute. That changed how I saw a need for God. My walk with the Lord's always been kind of petty. It's kind of just been, you know, it's supposed to rain today. I don't want to get wet. My walk with the Lord's always been, I got these boo-boos, I need healing. Pretty me-focused. And then all of a sudden I got put in a spot where I had to turn and deliver the word. I had to give hope even when my petty circumstances weren't that great. It's pretty awesome. I'm super thankful. My heart jumps for joy with this. It's a huge task. It's a huge opportunity. And the coolest part about what's going on down there right now is God's building up the body of Christ. Any of the guys who go down there and sisters who go down there and they get a chance to minister down there, holy cow. They took a church that was 150 people every week. That's what we had down there. And then the one day I got an email that said, you're going to take that church and we're going to cut it into a third and we're going to smash you into this little section of the big area that you used to have. And, if you want the other people in your church to show up, then you can have another room in another place and you can just have two services at the same time. That seems pretty easy, right? Okay. So that was, 1 month after I took over this ministry. And I got a chance to seek the Lord. I got a chance to really find out what it is to shepherd a church. And to, no matter what your circumstance is, make sure that your direction is correct, where you're going. And then we got tested in it. And then I got to learn about the other part of shepherding, where you deal with all the squabbling and deal with the personalities, and the people. Holy cow. But the Lord has been growing me through that. He's been growing the church through it, and he's establishing himself down there. It's pretty phenomenal. I would say that today, our church down there is stronger than it's ever been before because these gentlemen love each other. And that's kind of right where I got led to my message, and I kind of let him have it a little bit last night. Similar tone, but a few different words in there. So, hey, if anybody here feels the urge to join into this ministry, there's huge opportunity here. So if you feel like maybe not necessarily that you're fond of going to a state penitentiary, but rather you want to get a chance to minister, maybe you're in that dry place, the white knuckle place of Christianity where you've walked with the Lord and maybe you feel hopeless, or maybe you feel, how can I say it? Like you're doing the right thing, but it's not fulfilled. You haven't found your purpose yet. I'd like to give you an opportunity to join in because there's a huge need down there and it's a huge training ground. Ask Bobby. That guy brings the word of God once a month down there. It's like a different Bobby down there. It's awesome because you get a chance to see needs and meet them. And you get a chance to do maybe things that you don't always get to do here, but it's true and it's active. And it's phenomenal. I can tell you that my life is more fulfilled right now than it ever has been before. It's an awesome place of contentment to be. Anyway, let's jump into this. If you do want to join, it starts, there's a training this Tuesday at 6 p.m. Anyway, come see me afterward. That's my last pitch. You guys don't have to give anything else up to this point. You know, there's a huge foundation that we have to start with here in order for me to get through this message. First of all, is that everybody in this room, if you don't believe in what I'm going to say, you need to raise your hand. That our Savior, Jesus Christ, came to this earth, that he died on the cross for all mankind. If you think that your life is okay where it's at, and you've never come to know the Lord, I'm going to say that you're missing out on life itself. And all of you that have walked with the Lord and you've accepted him, maybe it's time to look back at that and let your vow be renewed. Is there anybody here who doesn't know the Lord as their Savior? Good. We're all brothers and sisters. See, it all started... I did a message down there about, we did a little study through Galatians 6. It was about the body of Christ and bearing ye one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. And that's when the Lord began to burden me with the body of Christ. I know that this message just lands right here at home too. And that, there's simple aspects that we miss sometimes, that we come to church and that we dress it up right. But that there's a certain aspect of church that we miss. And that's the body of Christ. Sometimes we don't nurture it. Sometimes we don't take care of it. Even further than that, let's jump right into some scripture. Matthew 5, 23 and 24. It says, therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar, and go thy way. First be reconciled to the brother, and then come to me and offer thy gift. Okay, so I spilled the beans. I'm preaching a little bit about forgiveness. Because if you were able to accept God's forgiveness, and acknowledging that he died on the cross for you, and that he forgave you from the filthiest of filthy sins, that no matter how deep and how hard you tried, he still can cover that. You're still good. But then the next part of it is that he wants us to step forward to forgive one another. Dang it. Okay. Alan, you wanted a simple word. Here it is. Alan was preaching at me in the parking lot, and he didn't know that I was preaching today. And then he began to rehearse some of my message to me. But let's jump over to Matthew 6, 14 and 15. Just turn the page, really. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. Okay, so the Bible, usually you got to like have these spiritual eyes to see stuff. What I'm telling you right now is that that is as plain and simple as it gets right there. The revelation's deep, but what I can tell you is that the truth is simple. If you don't forgive, how can you be forgiven? So yeah, we've started with that initial foundation where Jesus died and forgave us for our sins when he overcame the grave after the cross, sorry. But then the next part of it is that we fulfill the body of Christ, the law of Christ. We forgive one another. So what are we keying in on then? It's this thing called offense. The hook of Satan. I'm going to go through a few key points that came right out of offense. Some hands-on stuff here. And if you are able to stop and actually open your heart and maybe do a little bit of self-examination, you're going to see that none of us are really exempt from this. God's just been working me with this. So, a couple of things. First of all, this concept of not just being forgiven, but to forgive other people, we have to transition out of just being the receiver, which means that we no longer can have a walk with the Lord that's just me focused. Because all of a sudden it matters who's around you. See, if there was just one of me, and I didn't have a whole bunch of you here too, there wouldn't be offense. Hopefully not. That would be awkward. Right? But what I'm saying is that because we are the body of Christ and that we are members one of another, and that when this offense happens, God has called us to a crazy aspect that's so opposite of the world's culture, and that we're supposed to lay down our lives and we're supposed to forgive one another. That we're supposed to take something that's hurt us, and instead of nurturing it and making it our declaration, we're supposed to turn it. We're supposed to put it down. We're supposed to turn the other cheek and go and forgive someone else. It's interesting because, the guys down in the prison, they're very vocal about it. They really take the rebuke each other very seriously. Right? But really when he's calling us to rebuke each other with this, he's calling us out not necessarily to slay one another, but But what he's after is that we're supposed to vocalize it. We're supposed to say something. That when that offense has occurred, rather than letting it dig in. See, the crazy part about offense is that as soon as it plants, it doesn't sizzle out. As soon as offense is planted, it grows. I'm going to be real with you. This is something that kept me subdued for a long time in my own life. It's called the root of bitterness. Let me get some water. Thank you guys for being so quiet. See, that root of bitterness, it's kind of a brutal thing because nobody really wants to admit that they have it. But in all reality, it's because we've given in and let it into our lives. Yeah? I'll tell you this. Nobody is beyond offense. So if you're willing to sit here and say, yes, I declare that Christ is my Lord, I'm going to declare this, that you could be offended. You may be offended. You could be offending. Okay. So, maybe it's time we start looking past ourselves. That's hard to do, just so you know. But God has called us to another way of living. It's a new way of living. I don't want to get ahead of myself too far here. But really what I'm after here is that it's time to clean house. And that we can let these things fester and sizzle in our hearts, and we can nurture them and water them, and they'll grow faster. But the Lord would say that it's time to clean house. You know, for me, my walk with the Lord, it's always been at times of loss that I have been most open. One of the deepest dealings that God ever did in my life was through Tim Morton. I don't know if he's here tonight. Yeah. When he was fighting for his life. And God revealed himself through the body of Christ to me and showed me what impact I have. And God challenged me to step up. Not only to pray for him, but also to stop living like hell. Because it affects. Because we're members one of another. I do construction, believe it or not. And there's this kind of wood called pressure-treated lumber. And when you get a sliver of it in your hand, it doesn't take more than like an hour before you know it's there. And it doesn't take about a day before it becomes red and swollen. And then if you really leave it there, like you try to keep it in there long enough, that pressure-treated sliver, eventually that's all you're going to think about because it becomes so much a part of your life and so distracting that you can't do anything else. You can't sleep. You can't touch anything with it. Huh, Matthew? Yeah. So what I'm saying is that this root of bitterness is the same way. So eventually it's going to take you out. It's going to knock you down. It's going to immobilize you. Sure, the rest of my body's healthy. I've got this one little sliver here. It's got me. Sometimes it's so petty and so little you can barely see it, but still, it's got me. What the heck? Big, strong guy. A little sliver takes me down. Right? It's time to clean house. Start pulling those slivers. Hey, listen to this. We're God's army. We sung about it today. We're overcomers. So how is it that God's army can overcome any weapon that's formed against them? Overcome death and hell and sin and all these good things. And really, the only thing that has a chance of taking us out is ourselves. The hook of Satan. He doesn't have to take us down. He's just got to immobilize us where we can't do anything. Right? That's how he wins. Yeah? Don't get neutralized. Don't get neutralized. Let's see here. And that heart, that moment of my heart came out of Psalm 55, if you want to take notes and go back and read it at some other time. But really, it was the cry of David saying, you know, that it's not my enemies that I'm worried about. You know? Let's see here. So I've got four tactical parts for you guys. And this is the part that hurt me the most, mainly because I've experienced all four of these parts. I'm super not proud of it, but I'm just going to be real with you about it. The first one, how offense can take us out when we have an entitlement issue. Come on, you don't have to say it out loud if you've got this. Just go ahead and nod your heart, okay? Do you feel that you deserve something? There's another level of entitlement where you can look at the body of Christ and its functioning and you go, they really should do this. Who here has had the they really should moment? Come on. So easy to point out everybody's faults and their shortcomings. Because here it is. We are all sons of God. So who here deserves more grace? The entitlement mentality puts your level of deserving above everyone else. Who here really merits more grace? I'd say his grace is sufficient for us. Number two. Oh, one more thing on the entitlement. Have you ever felt shortchanged? That's a tough one. Yeah? Wouldn't nod it out, Don. It hurts. But what I'm saying is it's real. I got the short end a few times around here. That was me. Poor me. It's because I felt like I deserved more. All right, next one. You saw this one come in, pride. I always swore to myself I'd never talk about pride in a message. Just because I know that God likes to work these things out in our lives. But this pride is not the arrogant one. Yeah, there's that side of it. The Bible held high pride, the shiny shoe pride, where you think that your stuff doesn't stink, right? But what I'm telling you is there's this other kind of pride that's the self-reliant pride. That's the one that got me real good. I like to declare that I'm a doer, that I like to get things done. I can make it happen. I'm a hands-on person. But that generally equals not God-reliant. So, do you feel that you can produce your own righteousness? Do you think that you're justifying yourself by the works that you do? Because I tried to do that for a lot of years. All right, number three. Unfairness. This is a classic Wilk attribute. All things shall be equal in the eyes of Wilks. Just ask Zachary and Samuel. If you lay down rules, they will abide by them. And if you don't, you're unfairly playing. There's this other side of it, where as soon as unfairness occurs, you feel undervalued. Maybe you've been done wrong because people don't value what you have. What you're offering. Okay, so it's good to be hungry for more and desire to serve more. But this can't be based on response from others, because then you will feel undervalued. So that's a motive issue. It's an intent issue. It's crazy how offense, really we try to make it about everybody else, but the issue is that it's about us, right? The key thing is knowing who you are and knowing where you're going. I've had the wonderful privilege of teaching the junior high boys on Wednesday nights. And one of my biggest heart's desire is to impart to them an identification. I think that if there's anything else that they can pull out of it, it's knowing who they really are. Because if they can fall back on that, they're not going to let the things of this world and the offenses and the what they're supposed to be try to give them facial structure of who they're supposed to be. But rather, they could be confident in who they really are and what they were made to do. And even further than that, that weird, awkward stage of life where you don't really know where you're going or where you're supposed to be. Really, you just wake up because mom tells you to. We all can relate to that, though. Maybe it's time that we start developing that. All right, here's my last point on this is of the offenses. It's respect. Say what? Respect. Guess what? We live in a world where we are supposed to demand respect. Right? I am this, and I deserve your respect. How twisted is that? That's so the opposite of who we are supposed to be. But rather, God says that we're to serve. Come on, let's be honest with ourselves, right? I demand respect from my kids. I demand respect from people when I earn it. Yeah? So I would say that one of the biggest things that I see happening is that our church, our body, has developed its own new culture in that we are moving past the things that the world defines us as right. So yeah, we have to abide by the law of the land, but I would say that the coolest part about this is that we serve a higher ranking God. We serve a God who's alive. And that as long as we are focused on that and as long as that's the direction we're going, you can't get distracted or sidetracked by all these other things. The offense will come in, but then you'll recognize it and you'll deal with it. So it's kind of crazy, but it just takes those moments in our prayer life and our walk with the Lord. And it takes a good wife or a good husband or a good brother or sister that are willing to start pointing some of these things out for you. I've got the best at that. No, really, what it is that we have to humble ourselves before him. Because the body of Christ, we work as a unit. And if we can go to one another in that rebuke of love and say, look, there is an offense here. Forgive me. How that changes everything. How that sets us apart so hugely from what the world is trying to do, where the world is just trying to grab and take from us at all times. Let's see here. Let's flip over to 2 Corinthians 10. Verse 3 through 5. He's always looking out for me. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And this is really the challenge. This is where God got me to, is that if we can set aside the pride and set aside the self-reliance and all these things, and we can actually start bringing into captivity those thoughts, Guess what? It happens by the renewing of your mind, water baptism. This is a big deal to me. I never really fully understood the power of water baptism. It was one of the single greatest moments of my walk with the Lord. But it's really becoming alive. I'm being saved. I'm walking this out now. What I can say is that the renewing of our mind each and every morning, those moments where we can bring into captivity those thoughts, and that's how we avoid the offense, rather than just dealing with the offense after it occurs. Bringing into captivity those thoughts. So guess what? Right back to that first scripture that I read. It's our worship. It's that when we bring that gift before the Lord, and he says, first, go clean house. He says, take the nastiness and the filth, take the offense, go deal with it, and then come bring that worship to me. Bring that gift before the throne. And I've totally missed that my whole life. Because I wait until I get there in worship, and then I try to make it right. All I've been doing is slinging mud at God. Right? It's painful. The coolest part about this, though, is that when renewing happens, you become alive. You become alive to his experience of God. You become alive to purpose. You become alive like you've never known before. Holy cow, God's just been doing this to me for like a year now. And it's been so personal and so deep. It's where I get before the Lord and I ask him to reveal himself to me. And then he'll share something with me and then I just take it. And then I apply it. And that renewing in my mind, of my heart, all of a sudden my intention is to live it out rather than just let it be something that's coming and going. It's scary, though, bringing that gift before the Lord, not knowing if we've lived it right, taking that chance. But I would say make this a daily occurrence where you renew, where you check yourself, getting back on target, where you deal with the offenses and the splitters and the slivers and the nastiness of life. And all of a sudden, when you go before the Lord, it's not this heaping pile that you got to deal with, but that when you come before him, you just go, Lord, cleanse me, wash me. Here I am. Here's my worship. Here's my gift. And watch him change you. All of a sudden, you become alive. It's crazy. I don't know how else to say it. It's just something that I've experienced, and I just get to share it with you now. Those moments where you become alive. It's like your eyes were opened. All of a sudden, you got a heartbeat, and you feel things, right? Yeah. Mike's glowing. Amen. Hey, check this out. It's so easy to just blame the environment. This is my last one that I'm going to pick on you with. All right? Now, when you come to give that gift to the Lord and it's not working out right, it's so easy to blame the song leader. You can blame the worship team. You can blame the sound room. We're good at that one too, right? We can blame, but really what it is that God wants us to clean house. He wants us to stop for a second and go, check yourself. That directly affects the quality of your gift. That directly affects your worship. I can tell you, and this is it for me, but if you begin to let God refine your character and refine your life like this, that you're going to find this level of satisfaction. It's so fulfilling. I tried really hard to be satisfied by fun things for a lot of years. But then there's this level of satisfaction that you can find when you're not chasing after the lust of the flesh. Yeah. When you're not pretending to play church, but rather loving the church. It's that level of servanthood. Yeah, showing up is okay. But when you show up with your heart open and clean and pure, amen, you'll find that satisfaction. You won't leave longing for anything but more of that. Amen. All right, guys, God bless you.